I can follow an account and it can be great for a season. And then I notice either the account starts to shift or my perception of the account starts to shift. And it's something that no longer is producing good fruit in my life. And so I think for me, it's also keeping in check what those things are seasonally. Because I think so often we think this is good forever, and that's not how life actually works.
I was thinking about this earlier. I've kind of most of my life been a high school ministry kind of guy. Like from like my first foray into ministry was I was 15 leading like the Bible club at my high school. You know, I've just always been a high school ministry dude. Then my junior year of college, I really needed a job. And I remember thinking to myself, a little bit beforehand when I was starting to volunteer with Young Life, like I'll do high school ministry, I'll do college ministry, I'll never do middle school ministry. Imagine my surprise when one of the first places that I got hired at to teach dance was at a middle school through Boys and Girls Club. And you know, it wasn't that I disliked middle schoolers, but I just didn't see myself having that aptitude or being immediately drawn towards that age group. But what I found was after like months of like showing up, you know, every day, being part of these kids' lives, trying to teach them things, et cetera, I woke up one day and I was like, whoa, I enjoy serving middle schoolers and whatnot, which I know sounds crazy, you know, to think about sometimes, or at least it did for me, you know? And it just made me realize we often think that we have to wait for us to feel a certain way before we do something, or like, I have to want to do that before I step into it. But the truth of the matter is the things that we give our time to are actually the things that we will end up having affection for, you know? Like it's not wait until you feel like it, it's do it first and then you'll feel like it later.
Yeah, I definitely think that the situations God has tended to use me most in my life are situations where I didn't necessarily want to do it or just was trying different options. And thinking about, I didn't necessarily have an affection for it when I started, and yet by the end of it, it was something that like I loved and cherished. And how often God uses at least my nose, and it sounds like your nose too, to say like, okay, you just said no, so let's actually say yes to this, and let's like shift your affections towards what I want you to focus on rather than what maybe you have this lofty idea of focusing on. Yeah, and I think same, my job is something that I never wanted to do. I had said no to like 5 times before graduating college. And yet I'm going into my 5th year and this is something that I'm like, I can't imagine what my life would have been had I not pursued that and tried it out. And said yes to some of those things too.
Yeah, definitely. A little birdie told me that you, like, I don't know, I've heard that you have a pretty strong filter on like what you choose to follow and stuff online. Like,
yeah, I definitely do. You
know, I'm just curious, like how do you decide? Like, oh yeah, I follow this person, or I follow that person, or like, you see this person, you're like, nope, you know, because I have my own thoughts behind it, but I want to hear yours first, because I feel like I kind of stumbled into the way that I choose who I follow and don't follow, but, you know, I have a feeling you're probably a bit more intentional about how you got to that point.
I don't know if it would say, like, that I was intentional or more if it was the way I was raised. I think I didn't grow up having a lot of like external media sources in my life, but my parents did ministry. And so it was always like, we're gonna choose which people we let in closer.
No Harry Potter, and no
so,
Wizards
yeah,
of Waverly
no
Place,
Harry Potter, you know? No, not a lot of TV. So I grew up on things that were already like very altered, and I never felt like I was missing out on those things. But I am very thankful for a mom who still to this day, if I'm on the phone with her, will be like, who are you hanging out with? Because I don't like this attitude, or I do like this attitude. And so I still have people who like check me on my attitudes. And I really appreciate having those people who are honest with me, especially in my mom. But she would tell us we couldn't hang out with certain friends growing up because she's like, I don't like the attitudes that you are showing now. Mm. And I think for me, I very much took that into what am I influencing as a whole? So like what books am I reading? Like what things am I allowing on my social media? And there's even over the last couple of years, especially, like I can follow an account and it can be great for a season. Mm. And then I notice either the account starts to shift or my perception of the account starts to shift. Mm. And it's something that no longer is producing good fruit in my life. Okay. And so I think for me, it's also keeping in check what those things are seasonally. Because I think so often we think this is good forever, and that's not how life actually works. Mm-hmm. Nothing can be good in all seasons. And I think about how even in farming, we have to let the ground rest every 4 or 5 years. And how are we pulling things out when they're no longer producing good fruit or needing to have a rest in that? So that's kind of how I tend to filter things and asking like, oh, am I changing my attitude because of either people or things that I'm allowing into my life?
Yeah. So it's not like an arbitrary, like, you know, I follow this person because of this, or don't follow this person because of this, but it's like, what is that thing doing inside of me? Yeah. That's how you're going to choose.
Yeah, what nutrients am I gaining from that? So like, am I gaining good fruit? Am I gaining good nutrients for my own life and for the seasons I'm going through? And there's things that can be incredible for one season and totally detrimental in others. And I've noticed that a lot in the last year in my life of even books I've been reading recently. I'm like, this is not good for right now. Or I actually need to focus more on some of the things this is talking about.
Yeah. I don't know, Kate, I don't know if this ever happens to you, but I remember when I was in high school, there was a time where, you know, I was trying to keep up with a lot of like new video game stuff that was coming out. This was like around the time that the Xbox One and the PlayStation 4. They all get mixed up in my mind sometimes, but it was around the time that they were coming out. And so I was trying to be like on top of my game in terms of like all the different updates and stuff. And so there was this one YouTuber that I enjoyed watching. And as I watched his stuff, I was learning all these cool things, and he had cool like hot takes and spicy perspectives and stuff. And I was like, oh yeah, I feel edgy and cool, and I feel like I'm on the inside. But he also, you know, he had like some crude jokes here and there, you know, and he said some stuff that was like not the most like Christian filter, so to speak, on the way that he spoke. And it wasn't even necessarily that I started talking like that guy, but in my mind, people would say things and I would respond in my mind the way that that guy would respond. Like I would think thoughts that were similar to the things that I was hearing him say and like phrases he would use in his YouTube videos. And one day I realized like, whoa, why did I think that just now? Or like, why am I feeling this way about this thing? And it's not that I wanted to think those things, not that I wanted to feel a certain way. Because sometimes like, we tell people, oh, just stop feeling like X, Y, or Z. But that's not always super feasible for someone to do. You can't just be like, stop feeling that way, you know. But what we can say and what we can note is that sometimes the things that we're consuming are leading us to feel that way. You know, like I understand why people say things like, oh, you know, choose joy. I understand it, but I sometimes have a problem with saying just choose joy and not elaborating on what that means. About a week or so ago, I was given a devotional at work and talking about Philippians chapter 4 and how Paul says, be anxious for nothing. And we hear stuff like that and we're like, oh, be anxious for nothing. Like, why did you have anxiety? Come on now. But we have to let that play out. It's like, be anxious for nothing, but pray about everything. And I think the Message version says, shape your worries into prayer. Mm-hmm. And then it goes on from there and it says like, bring it to God with thanksgiving. Okay, I got a battle plan now. I'm worried about something, let me give thanks to God about something related to that thing. And then it says, and supplication, make your request known to the Lord. Okay, let me, you know, make my request known to God about that thing, okay? Plan is continuing. We've got some more steps in here. Then he says, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is good, think about these things. It's like, oh, okay. So So now I need to, so active moment, give thanks, make your request known to the Lord. But now passively, we have to cultivate a mind space that has, you know, us thinking about what's good, what's right, what's noble, what's true. And, you know, it may sound kind of cringy and kind of like, you know, that's weird, AJ, but maybe like it's really helpful to follow Christian YouTubers and Christian Instagram accounts and Christian TikTokers. And it's like filling up my timeline with more like of the word and with more scripture and people like, you know, giving like healthy, solid perspective on like what God's word has to say and on life and stuff. That is so much more helpful to me than, you know, even like, you know, like I make music and stuff, like having more music stuff on my timeline. Now, I do want to have more music stuff on my timeline, but the idea is, like what you're saying, like, what are these things doing to me? If you want to grow in music, spend more time around musicians and fill your content and your timeline with music stuff. If you want to grow in godliness, fill your timeline with the word of God, you know? But that was a really long way of saying, I agree exactly with what you're saying, and that your parents were like, who are you hanging out with? Or, you know, don't watch that show or don't input that thing, because those inputs, they do something to you.
Yeah, I think a lot of times people don't understand the amount of even little things can be inputs in your life. Mm-hmm. I think one of my favorite quotes, like talking about like, what are you putting in gratitude and things like that? And what you were just saying, one of my favorite life quotes is by Henry Nouwen, and it's from Life of the Beloved, which is a great book as it is. But in it, he says, gratitude begets gratitude just as love begets love. And it's this concept of what are you wanting to do and how do you fill your life with those things that then will reflect that. So if you're wanting gratitude, even when it's in the hard process, you need to be cultivating that gratitude. You need to be filling your life with other people that reflect that gratitude, other influences that reflect that gratitude. And I think that goes to like what you were saying as well of how are we shaping even our prayer and our desires to reflect what we want to be cultivating. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a great point.
Yeah.